Namaste, myself Ankita Shreya Prasad, and you are listening to along with our NCERT 11th and 12th audio video book presented by Artskill Passion. Unit 3, Electrochemistry. Electrochemistry is the study of production of electricity from energy released during spontaneous chemical reactions and the use of electrical energy to bring about non-spontaneous chemical transformations. The subject is of importance both for theoretical and practical considerations. A large number of metals, sodium hydroxide, chlorine, fluorine, and many other chemicals are produced by electrochemical methods. Batteries and fuel cells convert chemical energy into electrical energy and are used on a large scale in various instruments and devices. The reactions carried out electrochemically can be energy efficient and less polluting. Therefore, study of electrochemistry is important for creating new technologies that are eco-friendly. The transmission of sensory signals through cells to brain and vice versa, and communication between the cells are known to have electrochemical origin. Electrochemistry is therefore a very vast and interdisciplinary subject. In this unit, we will cover only some of its important elementary aspects. 3.1. Electrochemical cells. In class 11th, unit 8, we had studied the construction and functioning of Daniell cell. The cell converts the chemical energy liberated during the redox reaction. Zn plus Cu2 plus gives rise to Zn2 plus plus Cu to electrical energy and has an electrical potential equal to 1.1 volt when concentration of Zn plus 2 and Cu plus 2 ions is unity, 1 more decimeter to the power of minus 3. Such a device is called a galvanic or a volatilic cell. If an external opposite potential is applied in the galvanic cell and increased slowly, we find that the reaction continues to take place till the opposing voltage reaches the value 1.1 volt. When the reaction stops altogether and no current flows through the cell, any further increase in the external potential again starts the reaction but in the opposite direction. It now functions as an electrolytic cell, a device for using electrical energy to carry non-spontaneous chemical reactions. Both types of cells are quite important and we shall study some of their silent features in the following pages. Figure 3.2. Functioning of Daniell cell when external voltage E external opposing the cell potential is applied. 3.2. Galvanic cells. As mentioned earlier, class 11th unit 8, a galvanic cell is an electrochemical cell that converts the chemical energy of a spontaneous redox reaction into electrical energy. In this device, the Gibbs energy of the spontaneous redox reaction is converted into electrical work, which may be used for running a motor or other electrical gadgets like heater, fan, geysers, etc. Daniell cell discussed earlier is one such cell in which the following redox reaction occurs. Zn plus 2 plus give rise to Zn plus 2 plus Cu. This reaction is a combination of two Hopf reactions whose addition gives the overall cell reaction. Cu plus 2 plus 2e give rise to Cu. Second, Zn give rise to Zn plus 2 plus 2e. Oxidation of reaction. These reactions occur in two different portions of the Daniell cell. The reduction Hof reaction occurs on the copper electrode, while the oxidation Hof reactions occur on the zinc electrode. These two portions of the cells are also called Hof cells or redox couples. The copper electrode may be called the reduction Hof cell and the zinc electrode the oxidation Hof cell. We can construct innumerable number of galvanic cells on the pattern of Daniell cell by taking combination of different Hof cell. Each Hof cell consists of a metallic electrode dipped into an electrolyte. The two Hof cells are connected by a metallic wire through a voltmeter and a switch externally. The electrolytes of the two Hof cells are connected internally through a salt bridge as shown in figure 3.1. Sometimes both the electrodes dip in the same electrolyte solution, and in such cases we do not require a salt bridge. At each electrode-electrolyte interface there is a tendency of metal ions from the solution to deposit on the metal electrode, trying to make it positively charged. At the same time, metal atoms of electrode have a tendency to go into the solution as ions and leave behind the electrons at the electrode, trying to make it negatively charged. At equilibrium, there is a separation of charges, and depending on the tendencies of the two opposing reactions, the electrode may be positively or negatively charged with respect to the solutions. A potential difference develops between the electrode and the electrolyte, which is called electrode potential. When the concentration of all the species involved in a Hof cell is unity, then the electrode potential is known as standard electrode potential. According to IUPAC conventions, standard reduction potential are now called standard electrode potentials. In a galvanic cell, the Hof cell in which oxidation takes place is called anode, and it has a negative potential with respect to the solution. The other Hof cell in which reduction takes place is called cathode, and it has a positive potential with respect to the solution. Thus, there exists a potential difference between the two electrodes, and as soon as the switch is in the on position, the electrons flow from negative electrode to positive electrode. The direction of current flow is opposite to that of electron flow. The potential difference between the two electrodes of a galvanic cell is called the cell potential and is measured in volts. The cell potential is the difference between the electrode potential, reduction potential of the cathode and anode. It is called the cell electromotive force, EMF, of the cell. When no current is drawn through the cell, it is now an accepted convention that we keep the anode on the left and the cathode on the right. While representing the galvanic cell, a galvanic cell is generally represented by putting a vertical line between metal and electrolyte solution and putting a double vertical line between the two electrolytes connected by a salt bridge. Under this convention, the EMF of the cell is positive and is given by the potential of Hof cell on the right hand side minus the potential of the Hof cell on the left hand side, that is, E cell is equal to E right minus E left. This is illustrated by the following examples. Cell reaction Cu plus 2Ag give rise to Cu plus 2 plus 2Ag. Off cell reactions. Cathode reduction 2Ag plus plus 2E minus give rise to 2Ag. Anode oxidation Cu give rise to Cu plus 2 plus 2E. It can be seen that the sum of 3.5 and 3.6 leads to overall reaction 3.4 in the cell, and the silver electrode act as a cathode and copper electrode act as an anode. The cell can be represented as Cu, Cu plus 2 and Ag plus Ag. We have E cell is equal to E right minus E left is equal to EAg minus ECU plus 2 Cu. The potential of individual Hopf cell cannot be measured. We can measure only the difference between the two Hopf cell potential that gives the EMF of the cell. If we arbitrarily choose the potential of one electrode Hopf cell, then that of the other can be determined with respect to this. According to convention, a Hopf cell called standard hydrogen electrode represented by PtH2H+ is assigned a zero potential at all temperatures corresponding to the reaction. H+ plus E- give rise to 1 by 2 H2. The standard hydrogen electrode consists of a platinum electrode coated with platinum black. The electrode is dipped in an acidic solution and pure hydrogen gas is bubbled through it. The concentration of both the reduced and oxidized forms of hydrogen is maintained at unity. This implies that the pressure of hydrogen gas is 1 bar and the concentration of hydrogen ion in the solution is 1 molar. At 298 Kelvin, the EMF of the cell standard hydrogen electrode seconds. Hopf cell constructed by taking standard hydrogen electrode as anode, reference Hopf cell, and the other Hopf cell as cathode gives the reduction potential of the other Hopf cell. If the concentration of the oxidized and the reduced forms of the species in the right hand Hopf cell are unity, then the cell potential is equal to standard electrode potential ER of the given Hopf cell. E minus is equal to E minus R minus E minus L. As E minus L for standard hydrogen electrode is 0, E minus is equal to E minus R minus 0 is equal to E minus R. The measured EMF of the cell PtH2 gas 1 bar, H plus aqueous 1 molar, Cu plus 2 aqueous 1 m. Cu is 0.34 volt, and it is also the value for the standard electrode potential of the Hopf cell corresponding to the reaction. Cu plus 2 plus 2E minus give rise to Cu. Similarly, the measured EMF of the cell PtH2 1 bar plus H plus aqueous 1 molar Zn plus 2 aqueous 1 molar Zn is 0 minus 0.76 volt, corresponding to the standard electrode potential of the Hopf cell reaction. Zn 2 plus aqueous 1 m plus 2E minus give rise to Zn S. The positive value of the standard electrode potential in the first case indicates that Cu plus 2 ions get reduced more easily than H plus ions. The reverse processes cannot occur, that is, hydrogen ion cannot oxidize Cu, or alternatively, we can say that hydrogen gas can reduce copper ion. Under the standard condition described above, the Cu does not dissolve in HCl in nitric acid. It is oxidized by nitrate ion and not by hydrogen ion. The negative value of standard electrode potential in the second class indicates that hydrogen ion can oxidize zinc or zinc can reduce hydrogen ions. In view of this convention, the Hopf reaction for the Daniell cell in figure 3.1 can be written as left electrode Zn give rise to Zn plus 2 plus 2e minus. Right electrode Cu 2 plus plus 2e minus give rise to Cu. The overall reaction of the cell is the sum of above two reactions and we obtain the equation Zn plus Cu plus 2 give rise to Zn 2 plus plus Cu. EMF of the cell is equal to E minus L is equal to E minus R minus E minus L is equal to 0.34 volt minus of minus 7.6 volt is equal to 1.10 volt. Sometimes metals like platinum or gold are used as inert electrodes. They do not participate in the reaction but provide their surface for oxidation or reduction. Reactions and for the conduction of electrons, for example, Pt is used in the following Hopf cell. Hydrogen electrode Pt H2 H plus with Hopf cell reaction H plus plus E minus give rise to 1 by 2 H2. Bromine electrode Pt Br2 Br minus with Hopf cell reaction 1 by 2 Br2 plus E minus give rise to Br minus. The standard electrode potential are very important and we can extract a lot of useful information from them. The values of standard electrode potentials for some selected Hopf cell reduction reactions are given in table 3.1. If the standard electrode potential of an electrode is greater than 0, then its reduced form is more stable compared to hydrogen gas. Similarly, if the standard electrode potential is negative, then hydrogen gas is more stable than the reduced form of species. It can be seen that the standard electrode potential for fluorine is the highest in the table, indicating that fluorine gas F2 has the maximum tendency to get reduced to fluoride ions F minus, and therefore fluorine gas is the strongest oxidizing agent and fluorine ion is the weakest reducing agent. Lithium has the lowest electrode potential, indicating that lithium ion is the weakest oxidizing agent, while lithium metal is the most powerful reducing agent in an aqueous solution. It may be seen that as we go from top to bottom in table 3.1, the standard electrode potential decreases, and with this decreases the oxidizing power of the species on the left and increasing the reducing power of the species on the right hand side of the reaction. Electrochemical cells are extensively used for determining the pH of solutions, solubility product, equilibrium constant and other thermodynamic properties, and for potentiometric titrations. 3.3 Nernst equation. We have assumed in the previous section that the concentration of all the species involved in the electrode reaction is unity. This need not to be always true. Nernst showed that for the electrode reaction Mn plus plus Ne minus M, the electrode potential at any concentration measured with respect to standard hydrogen electrode can be represented by E M N plus and M is equal to E minus Mn plus M minus RT by NF in M divided by Mn plus. But concentration of solid M is taken as unity and we have E Mn plus by M is equal to E minus Mn plus divided by M minus RT by NF I1N 1 divided by Mn plus. E minus Mn plus divided by M has already been defined. R is gas constant. 8.314 joule kilometer inverse mole inverse. F is Faraday constant, 96487 coulomb mole per inverse. T is temperature in Kelvin, and Mn plus is the concentration of the species Mn plus. Table 3.1, standard electrode potential at 298 Kelvin. Ions are present as aqueous species and H2O as liquid. Gases and solids are shown by gases and solids. First one, a negative E minus means that the redox couple is a stronger reducing agent than H plus and H2 couple. Second, a positive E means that the redox couple is a weaker reducing agent than H plus and H2 couple. In Daniell's cell, the electrode potential for any given concentration of Cu plus 2 and Zn plus 2 ions, we write for cathode E Cu plus 2 and Cu is equal to E minus Cu plus 2 Cu minus RT divided by 2F in 1 by Cu plus 2 and in aqueous form. For anode, E Zn plus 2 and Zn is equal to E minus Zn plus 2 Zn minus RT by 2F in 1 divided by Zn plus 2 aqueous. The cell potential E cell is equal to E Cu plus 2 and Cu minus E Zn plus 2 Zn is equal to E minus Cu 2 plus Cu minus RT divided by 2F in 1 divided by Cu 2 plus minus E minus Zn 2 plus Zn plus RT 2F in 1 divided by Zn 2 plus aqueous is equal to E minus Cu plus 2 Cu minus E minus Zn plus 2 Zn minus RT 2F in 1 by Cu plus 2 aqueous minus 1 N 1 divided by Zn 2 plus aqueous. E cell is equal to E minus cell minus RT divided by 2F in Zn plus 2 divided by Cu 2 plus. It can be seen that E cell depends on the concentration of both Cu plus 2 and Zn plus 2 ions. It increases with increase in the concentration of Cu 2 plus ions and decreases in the concentration of Zn 2 plus ions by converting the natural logarithm in equation 3.11 to the base 10 and substituting the values of R, F and T is equal to 298 Kelvin. It reduces to E cell is equal to E minus cell minus 0.059 divided by 2 log Zn 2 plus Cu 2 plus. We should use the same number of electrons N for both the electrodes and thus for the following cell. Ni 2 plus Ag plus Ag. The cell reaction is Ni plus 2 Ag plus give rise to Ni 2 plus plus 2 Ag. The next equation can be written as E cell is equal to E minus cell minus RT divided by 2F in Ni2 plus divided by Ag plus 2. And for a general electrochemical reaction of the type AA plus BB give rise to Ne in the reactor CC plus DD. Next equation can be written as E cell is equal to E minus cell minus RT by NF 1NQ is equal to E minus cell minus RT by NF 1NC to the power C, D to the power D and A to the power A and B to the power B. 3.3.1 Equilibrium constant from Nernst equation. If the circuit in the Daniell cell is closed, then we note that the reaction shutdown plus Cu, 2 plus give rise to Zn, 2 plus plus Cu takes place, and as time passes, the concentration of Zn 2 plus keeps on increasing, while the concentration of Cu 2 plus keeps on decreasing. At the same time, voltage of the cell as read on the voltmeter keeps on decreasing. After some time, we shall note that there is no change in concentration of Cu 2 plus and Zn 2 plus ions, and at the same time voltmeter gives zero readings. This indicates that equilibrium has been attained. In this situation, the Nernst equation may be written as E cell is equal to 0 is equal to E minus cell minus 2.303 RT by 2F log Zn 2 plus by Cu 2 plus, or E minus cell is equal to 2.303 RT divided by 2F log Zn 2 plus divided by Cu 2 plus. But at equilibrium, Zn 2 plus divided by Cu 2 plus is equal to Kc for the reaction 3.1, and at T is equal to 298 Kelvin, the above equation can be written as E minus L is equal to 0.059 O divided by 2 log Kc is equal to 1.1 volt. Log Kc is equal to 1.1 volt into 2 divided by 0.059 volt is equal to 37.288. Kc is equal to 2 into 10 to the power 37 at 298 Kelvin. In general, E minus L 2.303 RT divided by NF log Kc. This gives a relationship between equilibrium constant of the reaction and standard potential of the cell in which that reaction takes place. Thus, equilibrium constants of the reaction, difficult to measure otherwise, can be calculated from the corresponding E minus value of the cell. 3.3.2 Electrochemical cell and Gibbs energy of the reaction. Electrical work done in 1 second is equal to electrical potential multiplied by total charge passed. If we want to obtain maximum work from a galvanic cell, then charge has to be passed reversibly. The reversible work done by a galvanic cell is equal to decrease in its Gibbs energy, and therefore if the EMF of the cell is E and NF is the amount of charge passed and delta RG is the Gibbs energy of the reaction, then delta RG is equal to minus NFE. It may be remembered that E cell is an intensive parameter, but delta RG is an extensive thermodynamic property and the value depends on N. Thus, if we write the reaction Zn plus Cu2 plus give rise to Zn2 plus plus Cu, delta RG is equal to minus 2Fe. But when we write the reaction 2Zn plus 2Cu aqueous, 2Zn 2 aqueous plus 2Cu, delta RG is equal to minus 4Fe cell. If the concentration of all the reacting species is unity, then E cell is equal to E minus cell, and we have delta RG minus is equal to minus NF E minus cell. Thus, from the measurement of E minus cell, we can obtain an important thermodynamic quantity delta RG minus standard Gibbs energy of the reaction. From the later, we can calculate equilibrium constant by the equation delta RG minus is equal to minus RT in Kelvin. 3.4 Conductance of electrolytic solutions. It is necessary to define a few terms before we consider the subject of conductance of electricity through electrolytic solutions. The electrical resistance is represented by the symbol R, and it is measured in ohm, which in terms of SI base units is equal to kg meter squared by s cube a squared. It can be measured with the help of Wheatstone bridge, with which you are familiar from your study of physics. The electrical resistance of any object is directly proportional to its length, L, and inversely proportional to its area of cross section, A, that is, R is directly proportional to L divided by A, or R rho LA. The constant of proportionality rho, Greek rho, is called resistivity specific resistance. Its SI unit are ohm meter, ohm m, and quite often is sub multiple ohm centimeter. Ohm centimeter is also used. IUPAC recommends that use of the term resistivity over specific resistance, and hence in the rest of the book we shall use the term resistivity. Physically, the resistivity of a substance is its resistance when it is 1 meter long and its area of cross section is 1 meter square. It can be seen that 1 ohm meter is equal to 100 ohm centimeter, or 1 ohm centimeter is equal to 0.01 ohm meter. The inverse of resistance R is called conductance G, and we have the relation G is equal to 1 by R is equal to A rho L is equal to K A divided by L. The SI unit of conductance is Siemens, represented by the symbol S, and is equal to ohm to the power of minus 1, also known as MOHO or ohm inverse. The inverse of the resistivity called conductivity. Specific conductance is represented by the symbol K, Greek kappa. IUPAC has recommended the use of term conductivity over specific conductance, and hence we shall use the term conductivity in rest of the book. The SI unit of conductivity are S meter to the inverse of power 1, but quite often kappa is expressed in S centimeter inverse. Conductivity of a material, S meter inverse, is its conductance when it is 1 meter long and its area of cross section is 1 meter square. It may be noted that 1 S centimeter inverse is equal to 100 S meter to the power of minus 1. It can be seen from table 3.2 that the magnitude of conductivity varies a great deal and depends on the nature of material. It also depends on the temperature and pressure at which the measurements are made. Materials are classified into conductors, insulators, and semiconductors depending on the magnitude of their conductivity. Metals and their alloys have very large conductivity and are known as conductors. Certain non-metals like carbon black, graphite, and some organic polymers are also electronically conducting. Substances like glass, ceramics, etc., having very low conductivity, are known as insulators. Substances like silicon, doped silicon, and gallium arsenide, having conductivity between conductors and insulators, are called semiconductors and are important electronic materials. Certain materials called superconductors by definition have zero resistivity or infinite conductivity. Earlier, only metals and their alloys at very low temperatures, 0 to 15 Kelvin, we know to behave as superconductors, but nowadays a number of ceramic materials and mixed oxides are also known to show superconductivity at temperatures as high as 150 Kelvin. Electrical conductance through metals is called metallic or electronic conductance and is due to the movement of electrons. The electronic conductance depends on, first, the nature and structure of the metal, second, the number of valence electrons per atom, third, temperature. It decreases with increase of temperature. As the electrons enters at one end and go out through the other end, the composition of metallic conductors remain unchanged. The mechanism of conductance through semiconductors is complex. We already know class 11th unit 7 that every pure water has small amounts of hydrogen and hydroxyl ions, that is 10 to the power minus 7 m, which lends it to very low conductivity 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 5 m to the power of minus 1. When electrolytes are dissolved in water, they furnish their own ions in the solution, hence its conductivity also increases. The conductance of electricity by ions present in the solution is called electrolytic or ionic conductance. The conductivity of electrolytic ionic solution depends on, first, the nature of the electrolyte added, second, size of ions produced and their solvation, third, the nature of solvent and its viscosity, fourth, concentration of electrolyte, fifth, temperature. It increases with the increase of temperature. Passage of direct current through ionic solution over a prolonged period can lead to change in its composition due to electrochemical reactions. 3.4.1 Measurement of the conductivity of ionic solutions. We know that accurate measurements of an unknown resistance can be performed on Wheatstone bridge. However, for measuring the resistance of an ionic solution, we face two problems. Firstly, passing direct current DC changes the composition of the solution. Secondly, a solution cannot be connected to bridge like a metallic wire or other solid conductor. The first difficulty is resolved by using an alternating current AC source of power. The second problem is solved by using a specially designed vessel called conductivity cell. It is available in several designs and two simple ones are shown in figure 3.4. Basically, it consists of two platinum electrodes coated with platinum black. Finely divided metallic PT is deposited on electrodes electrochemically. These have area of cross-section equal to A and separated by distance L. Therefore, solution confined between these electrodes is a column of length L and area of cross-section A. The resistance of such a column of solution is then given by the equation. R is equal to rho LA is equal to L by kappa A. The quantity LA is called cell constant, denoted by the symbol G. It depends on the distance between the electrodes and their area of cross section and has the dimension of length inverse and can be calculated if we know L and A. Measurement of L and A is not only convenient but also unreliable. The cell constant is usually determined by measuring the resistance of the cell containing a solution whose conductivity is already known. For this purpose, we generally use KCl solution whose conductivity is known accurately at various concentrations. Table 3.3. At different temperatures, the cell constant G star is then given by the equation. G star is equal to L by A is equal to R kappa. Table 3.3. Conductivity and molar conductivity of KCl solution at 298.15 Kelvin. Once the cell constant is determined, we can use it for measuring the resistance or conductivity of any solution. The setup for the measurement of the resistance is shown in figure 3.5. It consists of two resistances R3 and R4, a variable resistance R1 and the conductivity cell having the unknown resistance R2. The Wheatstone bridge is fed by an oscillator O, a source of AC power in the audio frequency ranging 550 to 5000 cycles per second. P is a suitable detector, a headphone or other electronic devices,
and the bridge is balanced when no current passes through the detector. Under these conditions, unknown resistance R2, R1 into R4 divided by R3. These days, inexpensive connectivity meters are available which can directly read the conductance or resistance of the solution in the conductivity cell. Once the cell constant and the resistance of the solution in the cell is determined, the conductivity of the solution is given by the equation kappa cell constant divided by R is equal to G star by R. The conductivity of solution of different electrolytes in the same solvent and at a given temperature differs due to charge and size of the ions in which they dissociate. The concentration of ions or ceases with which the ions move under a potential gradient. It therefore becomes necessary to define a physically more meaningful quantity called molar conductivity, denoted by the symbol lambda, Greek lambda. It is related to conductivity of solution by the equation molar conductivity lambda m is equal to kappa divided by c. In the above equation, kappa is expressed in S meter inverse and the concentration in C in mole meter to the power of minus 3, and the units of lambda m are in S meter square mole inverse. It may be noted that 1 mole meter to the inverse of 3 is equal to 1000 liter meter cube into molarity mole liter, and hence lambda s centimeter square mole inverse is equal to k s centimeter inverse divided by 1000 l m to the power of minus 3 into molarity mole l to the power minus 1. If we use s centimeter inverse as unit of kappa and mole centimeter to the power of minus 3 the units of concentration, then the units of lambda m are s centimeter mole inverse. It can be calculated by using the equation lambda m s centimeter square mole to the power minus 1 is equal to kappa into 1000 divided by molarity mole divided by l. Both type of units are used in literature and are related to each other by the equation 1 s meter square mole inverse is equal to 10 to the power s centimeter square mole inverse, or 1 s centimeter square mole inverse is equal to 10 to the power minus 4 s meter square mole inverse. 3.4.2 Variation of conductivity and molar conductivity with concentration. Both conductivity and molar conductivity change with the concentration of the electrolyte. Conductivity always decreases with decrease in concentration. Both for weak and strong electrolytes, this can be explained by the fact that number of ions per unit volume that carry the current in solution decreases on dilution. The conductivity of a solution at any given concentration is the conductance of one unit volume of solution kept between two platinum electrodes with unit area of cross section and at a distance of unit length. This is clear from the equation G is equal to kappa A divided by L is equal to kappa. Both A and L are unity in their appropriate units in m or centimeter. Molar conductivity of a solution at a given concentration is conductance of the volume V of solution containing 1 mole of electrolyte kept between two electrodes with area of cross section A and distance of unit length. Therefore, lambda m is equal to kappa A divided by L is equal to kappa. Since L is equal to 1 and A is equal to V, volume containing 1 mole of electrolyte, lambda m is equal to kappa V. Molar conductivity increases with decrease in concentration. This is because the total volume V of the solution containing 1 mole of electrolyte also increases. It has been found that decrease in cupon dilution of a solution is more than compensated by increase in its volume. Physically, it means that a given concentration lambda m can be defined as the conductance of the electrolytic solution kept between the electrodes of a conductivity cell at unit distance but having area of cross section large enough to accommodate sufficient volume of solution that contains one mole of the electrolyte. When concentration approaches zero, the molar conductivity is known as limiting molar conductivity and is represented by the symbol lambda m. The variation in lambda m with the concentration is different. Figure 3.6 for strong and weak electrolytes. Strong electrolytes. For strong electrolytes, lambda m increases slowly with dilution and can be represented by the equation lambda m is equal to lambda m minus a c to the power of 1 by 2. It can be seen that if we plot figure 3.6 lambda m against c to the power of 1 by 2, we obtain a straight line with intercept equal to lambda m degrees and slope equal to minus a. The value of constant A for a given solvent and temperature depends on the type of electrolyte, that is, the charge on the cation and anion produced on the dissociation of electrolyte in the solution. Thus, NaCl, CaCl2, MgSO4 are known as 1:1, 2:1, and 2:2 electrolytes respectively. All electrolytes of a particular type have the same value of A. Kohlrau examined lambda m value of a number of strong electrolytes and observed certain regularities. He noticed that the difference in lambda m of the electrolytes NaX and KX for NaX is nearly constant. For example, at 298 Kelvin, lambda m KCl minus lambda m NaCl is equal to lambda m KBr minus lambda m NaBr is equal to lambda m Ki minus lambda m Nai, equivalence to 23.4 S centimeter square mole inverse. And similarly, it was found that lambda m NaBr minus lambda m NaCl is equal to lambda m KBr minus lambda m KCl, equivalence to 1.8 centimeter square mole inverse. On the basis of the above observation, he enunciated Kohlrau's law of independent migration of ions. The law states that limiting molar conductivity of an electrolyte can be represented as the sum of the individual contribution of the anion and cation of the electrolyte. Thus, if lambda Na plus and lambda Cl are limiting molar conductivity of the sodium and chloride ion respectively, then the limiting molar conductivity for sodium chloride is given by the equation lambda m NaCl is equal to lambda Na plus lambda Cl minus. In general, if an electrolyte on dissociation gives V plus cation and V minus anions, then its limiting molar conductivity is given by lambda m is equal to V plus lambda plus V minus lambda minus. Here, lambda plus and lambda minus are limiting molar conductivities of cation and anion respectively. The value of lambda degrees for some cations and anions at 298 kelvins are given in table 3.4. Weak electrolytes. Weak electrolytes like acetic acid have lower degrees of dissociation at higher concentration, and hence for such electrolytes, the change in lambda m with dilution is due to increase in the degree of dissociation and consequently the number of ions in total volume of solution that contain one mole of electrolyte. In such cases, lambda m increases steeply on dilution, especially near lower concentrations. Therefore, lambda m cannot be obtained by extrapolarization of lambda m to zero concentration. At infinite dilution, that is concentration C, give rise to zero, electrolyte dissociates completely, lambda is equal to 1. But at such low concentration, the conductivity of the solution is so low that it cannot be measured accurately. Therefore, lambda m for weak electrolytes is obtained by using Kolmogorov's law of the independent migration of ions, example 3.8, at any concentration C, if sigma is the degree of dissociation. Then it can be approximated to the ratio of molar conductivity lambda m at the concentration C to limiting molar conductivity lambda m. Thus we have alpha is equal to lambda m divided by lambda degree m, but we know that for a weak electrolyte like acetic acid, class 11th unit 7, Ka is equal to C alpha squared divided by 1 minus alpha is equal to C lambda m squared divided by lambda m squared into 1 minus lambda m by lambda degree m is equal to C lambda squared divided by lambda degree m into lambda m minus lambda m. Application of Kolmogorov's law. Using Kolmogorov's law of independent migration of ions, it is possible to calculate lambda m for any electrolyte from the lambda degree of individual ions. Moreover, for weak electrolytes like acetic acid, it is possible to determine the value of its dissociation constant. Once we know that lambda m and lambda m at a given concentration C. 3.5. Electrolytic cells and electrolysis. In an electrolytic cell, external source of voltage is used to bring about a chemical reaction. The electrochemical processes are of great importance in the laboratory and the chemical industry. One of the simplest electrolytic cells consists of two copper strips dripping in an aqueous solution of copper sulfate. If a DC voltage is applied to the two electrodes, then Cu plus 2 ions discharge at the cathode, negatively charged, and the following reaction takes place. Cu 2 plus plus 2 E minus give rise to Cu. Copper metal is deposited on the cathode. At the anode, copper is converted into Cu2 plus ion by the reaction. Cu S give rise to Cu2 plus plus 2E minus. Thus, copper is dissolved, oxidized at anode and deposited reduced at cathode. This is the basis for an industrial process in which impure copper is converted into copper of high purity. The impure copper is made an anode that dissolves on passing current, and pure copper is deposited at the cathode. Many metals like Na, Mg, Al, etc. are produced on large scale by electrochemical reduction of their respective cations, where no suitable chemical reducing agents are available for this purpose. Sodium and magnetism metals are produced by the electrolysis of their fused chlorides, and aluminium is produced, class 12 unit 6, by the electrolysis of aluminium oxide in presence of cryolite. Quantitative aspects of electrolysis. Michael Faraday was the first scientist who described the quantitative aspects of electrolysis. Now, Faraday's law also flows from what has been discussed earlier. Faraday's law of electrolysis, after his extensive investigation on electrolysis of solution and melts of electrolytes. Faraday published his results during 1833-34 in the form of the following well-known Faraday's two law of electrolysis. First law, the amount of chemical reaction which occurs at any electrode during electrolysis by a current is proportional to the quantity of electricity passed through the electrolyte solution or melt. Second law, the amounts of different substances liberated by the same quantity of electricity passing through the electrolytic solution are proportional to their chemical equivalent weights. Atomic mass of metal divided by number of electrons required to reduce the cation. There were no constant current sources available during Faraday's times. The general practice was to put a coulometer, a standard electrolytic cell, for determining the quantity of electricity passed from the amount of metal, generally silver or copper, deposited or consumed. However, coulometers are now obsolete and we now have constant current I source available, and the quantity of electricity Q passed is given by Q is equal to IT. Q is in coulombs when I is in ampere and T is in second. The amount of electricity or charge required for oxidation or the reduction depends on the stoichiometry of the electrode reaction. For example, in the reaction Ag plus aqueous plus E minus AgS, 1 mole of the electrons is required for the reduction of 1 mole of silver ions. We know that charge on one electron is equal to 1.6021 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Therefore, the charge on 1 mole of electrons is equal to Na into 1.6021 into 10 to the power minus 19. C is equal to 6.02 into 10 to the power 23 mole inverse into 1.6021 into 10 to the power minus 19. C is equal to 96487 coulomb mole inverse. The quantity of electricity is called Faraday and is represented by the symbol F. For approximate calculation, we use 1F equivalence to 96500 coulomb mole inverse for the electrode reaction. Mg plus plus 2E minus give rise to Mg, Al plus 3 plus 3E give rise to Als. It is obvious that 1 mole of Mg plus 2 and Al plus 3 require 2 mole of electrons 2F and 3 mole of electrons 3F respectively. The charge passed through the electrolytic cell during electrolysis is equal to the product of current in amperes and time in seconds. In chemical production of metals, current as high as 50,000 amperes are used that amounts to about 0.518 farenheit per second. 3.5.1 Product of electrolysis. Products of electrolysis depends on the nature of material being electrolyzed and the type of electrodes being used. If the electrode is inert, example platinum or gold, it does not participate in the chemical reaction and acts only as source or sink for electrons. On the other hand, if the electrode is reactive, it participate in the electrode reaction. Thus, the products of electrolysis may be different for reactive and inert electrodes. The products of electrolysis depends on the different oxidizing and reducing species present in the electrolytic cell and their standard electrode potential. Moreover, some of the electrochemical processes, although feasible, are so slow kinetically that a lower voltage that these not seem to take place, and extra potential called overpotential has to be applied, which makes such processes more difficult to occur. For example, if we use molten NaCl, the products of electrolysis are sodium metal and Cl2 gas. Here we have only one cation, Na+, which is reduced at the cathode. Na plus plus E minus give rise to Na and one anion Cl minus, which is oxidized at the anode, Cl- give rise to 1 by 2 Cl2 plus E-. During the electrolysis of aqueous sodium chloride solution, the products are NaOH, Cl2 and H2. In this cases, beside Na plus and Cl minus ions, we also have H plus and OH minus ions along with the solvent molecules H2O. At the cathode, there is competition between the following reduction reaction. Na plus E minus give rise to Na. E minus Cl is equal to minus 271 volt. H plus plus E minus give rise to 1 by 2 H2 gas. E minus Cl is equal to 0.00 volt. The reaction with higher value of E minus is preferred, and therefore the reaction at the cathode during electrolysis is H plus aqueous plus E minus give rise to 1 by 2 H2 gas. But H plus aqueous is produced by the dissociation of H2O, that is H2O give rise to H plus aqueous plus OH minus aqueous. Therefore, the net reaction at the cathode may be written as the sum of 3.33 and 3.34, and we have H2O L plus E minus give rise to 1 by 2 H2 gas plus OH minus. At the anode, the following oxidation reactions are possible. Cl minus give rise to 1 by 2 Cl2 plus E minus. E cell is equal to 1.36 volt. 2H2O L give rise to O2 plus 4H plus plus 4E minus. E cell is equal to 1.323 volt. The reaction at anode with lower value of E minus is preferred, and therefore water should get oxidized in preference to Cl minus aqueous. However, on account of overpotential of oxygen, reaction is preferred. Thus, the net reaction may be summarized as NaCl give rise to Na plus plus Cl minus in the presence of H2O. Cathode, H2O L plus E minus give rise to 1 by 2 H2 gas plus OH minus aqueous. Anode, Cl minus aqueous 1 by 2 Cl2 plus E minus. Net reaction, NaCl aqueous plus H2O L, Na plus aqueous plus OH minus aqueous plus 1 by 2 H2 gas plus 1 by 2 Cl gas. The standard electrode potentials are replaced by electrode potential by Nernst equation. Equation 3.8 to take into account the concentration effects. During the electrolysis of sulfuric acid, the following processes are possible at the anode. 2H2O L give rise to O2 gas plus 4H plus plus 4E minus. E cell is equal to plus 1.23 volt. 2SO4 minus 2 aqueous give rise to H2O O8, 2 minus aqueous plus 2 electrons. E cell is equal to 1.96 volt. For dilute sulfuric acid reactions is preferred, but at higher concentration of H2SO4 reaction, 3.39 is preferred. Any battery, actually it may have one or more than one cell connected in series, or cell that we use as source of electrical energy is basically a galvanic cell, where the chemical energy of the redox reaction is converted into electrical energy. However, for a battery to be practical use, it should be reasonably light, compact, and its voltage should not vary appreciably during its use. There are mainly two types of batteries. 3.6.1 primary battery. In the primary batteries, the reaction occurs only once, and after use over a period of time, battery becomes dead and cannot be reused again. The most familiar example of this type is dry cell, known as Leclanché cell after its discoverer, which is used commonly in our transistors and clocks. The cell consists of a zinc container that also acts as anode, and the cathode is a carbon graphite rod surrounded by the powdered manganese dioxide and carbon. The space between the electrodes is filled by a moist paste of ammonium chloride, NH4Cl, and zinc chloride, ZnCl2. The electrode reactions are complex, but they can be written approximately as follows. Anode ZnS gives rise to Zn2++2E-, cathode MnO2+NH4+E-MnOOH+NH3. In the reaction at cathode, manganese is reduced from the +4 oxidation state to the +3 state. Ammonia produced in the reaction forms a complex with Zn2+ to give ZnNH3(4)2+. The cell has potential of nearly 1.5 volt. Mercury cell figure 3.9 suitable for low current devices like hearing aids, watches, etc. Consists of zinc mercury amalgam as anode and a paste of HCO and carbon as the cathode. The electrolyte is a paste of KOH and ZnO. The electrode reaction for the cells are given below. Anode ZnHg+2OH- give rise to ZnO+H2O+2E-. Cathode HgO+H2O+2E- HgL+2OH-. The overall reaction is represented by ZnHg+HgO give rise to ZnO+Hg. The cell potential is approximately 1.35 volt and remains constant during its life, as the overall reaction does not involve any ion in solution whose concentration can change during its lifetime. 3.6.2. A secondary cell after use can be recharged by passing current through it in the opposite direction so that it can be used again. A good secondary cell can undergo a large number of discharging and charging cycles. The most important secondary cell is the lead storage battery, commonly used in automobiles and inverters. It consists of a lead anode and a grid of lead packed with lead dioxide, PbO2, as cathode. A 38% solution of sulfuric acid is used as an electrolyte. The cell reaction when the battery is in use are given below. Anode PbS+SO4(2)- give rise to PbSO4+2E-. Cathode PbO2+SO4-2+4H+2E- PbSO4+2H2OL. That is, overall cell reaction consisting of cathode and anode reaction is PbS+PbO2+2H2SO4 aqueous give rise to 2PbSO4+2H2O liquid. On charging the battery, the reaction is reversed and PbSO4S on anode and cathode is converted into Pb and PbO2 respectively. Another important secondary cell is the nickel cadmium cell, which has longer life than the lead storage cell but more expensive to manufacture. We shall not go into details of working of the cell and the electrode reaction during charging and discharging. The overall reaction during the discharge is Cd+2NiOH3 give rise to CdO+2NiOH2+H2O. 3.7. Fuel cells. Production of electricity by thermal plants is not a very efficient method and is a major source of pollution. In such plants, the chemical energy, heat of combustion of fossil fuel, coal, gas or oil is first used for converting water into high pressure steam. This is then used to run a turbine to produce electricity. We know that a galvanic cell directly converts the chemical energy into electricity and is highly efficient. It is now possible to make such cells in which reactants are fed continuously to the electrodes and products are removed continuously from the electrolyte compartment. Galvanic cells that are designed to convert the energy of combustion of fuels like hydrogen, methane, methanol, etc. directly into electrical energy are called fuel cells. One of the most successful fuel cells uses the reaction of hydrogen with oxygen to form water. The cell was used for providing electrical power in the Apollo space program. The water vapors produced during the reaction were condensed and added to the drinking water supply for the astronauts. In the cell, hydrogen and oxygen are bubbled through porous carbon electrodes into concentrated aqueous sodium hydroxide solution. Catalysts like finely divided platinum or palladium metals are incorporated into the electrodes for increasing the rate of electrode reaction. The electrode reactions are given below. Cathode O2 plus 2H2O plus 4E minus give rise to 4OH minus aqueous. Anode 2H2 plus 4OH minus aqueous give rise to 4H2OL plus 4E minus. Overall reaction being H2 plus O2 give rise to 2H2OL. The cell runs continuously as long as the reactants are supplied. Fuel cells produce electricity with an efficiency of about 70% compared to thermal plants whose efficiency is about 40%. There has been tremendous progress in the development of new electrode materials, better catalysts and electrolytes for increasing the efficiency of fuel cells. These have been used in automobiles on an experimental basis. Fuel cells are polluter-free, and in view of their future importance, a variety of fuel cells have been fabricated and tried. 3.8. Corrosion. Corrosion slowly coats the surface of metallic objects with oxidizers or other source of the metal. The rusting of iron, tarnishing of silver, development of green coating on copper and bronze are some of the example of corrosion. It causes enormous damage to buildings, bridges, ships and to all objects made of metal, especially that of iron. We lose crores of rupees every year on account of corrosion. In corrosion, a metal is oxidized by loss of electrons to oxygen and formation of oxides. Corrosion of ions, commonly known as rusting, occurs in presence of water and air. The chemistry of corrosion is quite complex, but it may be considered essentially as an electrochemical phenomenon. At a particular spot, Figure 3.13 of an object made of iron, oxidation takes place and the spot behaves as anode, and we can write the reaction. Anode 2Fe give rise to 2Fe2 plus plus 4E minus. E Fe2 plus plus Fe is equal to minus 0.44V. Electrons released at anodic spot move through the metal and go to another spot on the metal and reduce oxygen in the presence of H+, which is believed to be available from H2CO3 formed due to dissolution of carbon dioxide from air into water. Hydrogen ion in water may also be available due to dissociation of other acidic oxides from the atmosphere. This spot behaves as cathode with the reaction. Cathode O2 plus 4H plus plus 4E minus give rise to 2H2O L plus E minus H plus and O2 and H2O is equal to 1.23 volt, the overall reaction being 2Fe plus O2 plus 4H plus give rise to 2Fe2 plus 2H2O. E cell is equal to 1.67 volt. The ferrous ions are further oxidized by atmospheric oxygen to ferric ions, which come out as rust in the form of hydrated ferric oxide Fe2O3 XH2O, and with further production of hydrogen ions. Prevention of corrosion is of prime importance. It not only saves money but also helps in preventing accidents such as a bridge collapse or failure of a key component due to corrosion. One of the simplest methods of preventing corrosion is to prevent the surface of the metallic object to come in contact with atmosphere. This can be done by covering the surface with paint or by some chemicals, example bisphenol. Another simple method is to cover the surface by other method, metals, SN, ZN, etc. that are inert or react to seal the object. An electrochemical method is to provide a sacrificial electrode of another metal like Mg, Zn, etc., which corrodes itself but saves the object.
Thank you for being till the end. I hope this has helped you. If so, give thumbs up, like, share, comment, save, download and subscribe. You can support us by following in other platforms. That link is in the description. Well, thank you. See you later. Maybe never.